Good evening, and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Finley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario, California branch was started in May of 1988. Now, in the school, we use and teach by the true and originated titles for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word of Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. We now know that each Lord must have a name, each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But like Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super corporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifest himself in a physical body and walk the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in this school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith and was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. All right, we have a prayer tonight by Aaron Annelise. I forgot my list. And we have a selection of music after the prayer, and our scripture reading tonight will be Irene Ramirez. And our scripture lesson is Romans, the 14th chapter. And
Good evening.
Let us bow our hearts and minds. Dear Yahweh Elohim, please allow us to continue to know you as you are and truly exist. Continue to pull back the veil. Continue to give us your understanding so that we may do whatever you need of us. And all these things I ask, hallelujah.
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 see happen by chance. They want to believe that it's all in their hands. They try to convince me, they shape their own destinies. But if they knew ya, like I knew ya, they'd get down on their knees. Yes, if they knew ya, like I know ya, they'd get down on their knees. They don't know he's in complete control, and I am his running his show, yeah. He's in complete control, and I am his running his show. Freedom of choice is the law they're spreading around. Divine intervention is nice if God is ever around. They don't want to believe their every step was patterned by him, that he's got it wrapped up tight, light upon line. They're calling back the spirit again. He's got it wrapped up tight, light upon line. They're going back to spirit again. They don't know he's in complete control, and I am his running his show. He's in complete control, and I am his running his show. He's Alpha Omega, Almighty Creator, first cause of creation, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Alpha Omega, Almighty Creator, first cause of creation, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. You see ya. He told Jeremiah, I made you a prophet long before this earth had shape without form, before it was void. He said, I possessed your ways before I made the deep blue sea. I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. Yes, I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. They don't know he's in complete control, and I am his running his show, yeah. He's in complete control, and I am his running his show. He's Alpha Omega, Almighty Creator, first cause of creation, the Lamb slain from the Lamb slain from the Lamb slain from the foundation to the world. Alpha and Omega, Almighty Creator, cause of creation, the Lamb slain from the Lamb slain from the Lamb slain from the foundation.
Romans, the 14th chapter, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament. Romans 14. And that him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, do not judge his doubtful thoughts. For one believeth that he is many may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not. And let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth. For Yahweh hath received him. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holded up, for Yahweh is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto Yahweh. And he that regardeth not the day to Yahweh, he doeth not regard it. He that eateth to Yahweh, for he giveth him thanks. And he that eateth not to Yahweh eateth not, and giveth Yahweh thanks. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man die to himself. For whether we live unto Yahweh. And whether we die unto Yahweh. Whether we live, therefore, we die, we are Yahweh's. For to this end the Messiah both died and rose and revived, that he might be the ruler both of the dead and the living. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set all not thy brothers? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of the Messiah. For it is written, As I live, saith Yahweh, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to Yahweh. So then every one of us shall give account to himself to Yahweh. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know and I am persuaded by Yahshua Messiah that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean. To him it is unclean. But if thy brother be grieved with thy food, now walkest thou not charitable, but destroy not him with thy food, for whom the Messiah died. Let not your good be evil spoken of. For the kingdom of Yahweh is not eating and drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he that in these things serves the Messiah is acceptable to Yahweh and approved of men. Let us therefore follow after these things which make for peace, and things wherein one may edify another. For food destroyeth not the work of Yahweh. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for that man who eateth with offense. It is good neither to eat flesh nor drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth, or is offended, or is made weak. Hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before Yahweh. Happy is he that commandeth not himself, condemneth not himself in that thing which he alloweth. But he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith. For whosoever is not of faith is sin. I have read Romans, the 14th chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Okay, good evening to everybody here tonight, and those that are watching on YouTube and Facebook out in the world, okay? Tonight's our Thursday night class, okay? We're a small class tonight. So what we're going to do, we're going to have a two-speaker format tonight, okay? Our first speaker tonight will be Dr. Marlin Love.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Good to be here, here to make it on this Thursday evening in order to learn something about this gospel or this divine vision and revelation that was bequeathed into our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley.
Thought this might be a open mic night, but nonetheless,
something to edify the body, as was the scripture reader just read about the things that we eat and the things that we hear. Might hear other people talk about God and Lord, and now having have some faith being in Yahshua the Messiah, as we just talked about previously, the faith which is who he was, that came down on earth at a particular prescribed time towards the end of the third age in the fourth dispensation, by which he came in to fulfill the carnal ordinances that was set up by him in the previous ages or the previous worlds prior to. And this is what we will come to learn in this school, is about the faith of Yahshua the Messiah, whereby we eat that knowledge and that information, which was prescribed or talked about here in Romans, that Saul is talking about, that we eat and ought to have rest and faith and peace in that which we've learned, and then also be able to work with and deal with those around us, however, whatever they eat, not giving any offense to where they're coming from and what they're struggling with, and being patient and showing love unto them, even though they may not be strong in the full understanding of who Yahshua the Messiah was. They may still call him Jesus. I've been a big proponent of no J, no Jesus all my life. That was one of the first things I did learn about this teaching that made vivid clarity in my mind. But nevertheless, to, as some would say, badger and beat another person up over it day in and day out, not having anywhere else to go with all the charts that we have in order to talk about something that might be edifying to them, which Yahweh may bring to their consciousness about that letter J, being some 1,400 years after the death of Yahshua the Messiah, be proved to them. We can prove a lot of things. As my question was, I think on Tuesday night, Will went beautifully and described how Joshua, the son of Nun, down here in Egypt, was Yahshua the Messiah. He explained the 30 years when years old when he appeared down here in Egypt. And then he also expressed how Yahshua the Messiah, when he came in and was baptized by John, and he was 30 years old here at the River Jordan. He also went in and explained how Joshua, the son of Nun, led them as through the cloud and through the sea into the wilderness. Right. He expressed and talked about how they were able to stay here for 40 years because of unbelief of what was prescribed. We now know that it was endued upon, it was imposed upon the children of Israel to go through this process. But this process required 40 years, understanding that it was a day for a year that Yahweh imposed it upon the children of Israel at that time, picking up in this holy place compartment here of the 40 years. We now know that when the Messiah was baptized by John, and this cloud came down and a dove settled, and John called out as a forerunner to point to who Yahshua the Messiah was, Yahshua went straight away into the wilderness. And he stayed there for 40 days and was contended with Satan. You see? And then you also expressed how he went through this, the children of Israel migrated on up through the River Jordan, which would be correlating to your
second departmental veil here in the tabernacle. We have it depicted here. Let me back up real quick, and I'll use this chart here. This pattern is a key of heavenly things as far as a measuring rod or a tool by which we go by. Now, I briefly expressed Joshua or Hoshea down there in the son of Nun down in Egypt. This is correlated to this court roundabout on the tabernacle as far as lining it up. When we understand that this depicts at a time or a type of Egypt down there, we can understand that the process here. You have this holy place, which is synonymous to the wilderness here of Sinai. You have the most holy place, which is synonymous to Canaan's land,
right,
or the promised land. This is how we're looking at Joshua instituting and fulfilling according to a pattern. And it's within this pattern, we were able to line it up according to every other plate that's depicted on this chart in a threefold fashion, along with all the 40 plates that we have, whereby we don't get lost.
Right.
And we ought not be wavered. And we are eating or digesting or learning of this knowledge, which is of a vision. And there in Proverbs, it talked about the people perish, they have a vision. Or without a prophetic vision,
right,
the people perish. Let's go ahead and pick that up. You can find out. I think it's Proverbs, I want to say 28 and 4. And it's good to understand that we are not teaching a prescribed thought of a man's opinion. It needs to be made very clear that this vision that was given to Henry Clifford Kinley is not his is not his dream works of an imagination of a concept. Huh?
Said he said that himself.
Right. The speaker said he said that himself. But he didn't come up with this charts on his own. He didn't come up with the name Yahweh. He didn't come up with these things in order to raise a congregation of people. He died a pauper, didn't die wealthy at all, with a beautiful amount of information, and as oracle as he was, he didn't gain any riches, as it were. It wasn't for that purpose by which he came at the time of the year of 1931 in order to deliver the vision to us. Do you have the vision there?
Yes.
It says there in Proverbs
29 and 18.
Proverbs of Solomon. Go ahead.
Where there is no prophetic vision, the people perish.
There is no prophetic vision, the people perish. Read the next chapter, next verse, please.
But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. A servant will not be corrected by words. For though he understandeth, he will not answer. Seeing thou a man that is haste in his words, there is more hope of a fool than of him.
See, those other words that you're going to hear, the other food and the herbs that other people want to eat and try to bring unto you, as far as a gospel or as far as the learning about a vision, they're not looking at a vision. They're reading words out of a Bible or some other book. We shared an image of the book on Tuesday. What was the name of that book, Will, that we had, the big book by...
Dispensational Truth.
Dispensational Truth by who?
Clarence Larkin.
Clarence Larkin. That's a book of a bunch of words that people will bring unto you and try to feed you to get you to learn and know something about a spirit. Which you ask them about what is spirit, you get a melee of things. They don't have any consistency of things.
What you want is Proverbs 29:18.
29:18,
Proverbs.
Yeah, we just read it.
Oh, did you? I'm sorry,
yeah.
I missed it. I'm sorry. Where am I?
Holy name,
yeah.
Vision, or holy name, or...
No. I had them read on down further.
Oh, okay.
Get the words.
Okay,
because they'll have words of other books.
My error.
But they're not going to have the knowledge of the vision. And it was of the vision that Solomon is talking about there. It's a vision that the prophets received, because we understand, grab me Isaiah 1 and 1. Or any other prophets there. And get the continuity by which these prophets received the inspired words to write. Read.
The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amoz.
The vision of Isaiah. That's what Isaiah received. Obadiah received a vision. Nahum received a vision. Daniel received vision. In order to, Jeremiah received a vision. These are things that were given unto them. Just like the vision was given in Dr. King. Just like the vision was shown unto Moses here in Mount Sinai, on the backside here, when he saw this burning bush. A vision, 2 Peter 1 and 28, I believe. Please. We have to understand, we're not coming from books or just a compiling of information to come up with and to line this story up. It's a vision. I'm going to need Exodus 25, 8, 9, 2. You have that?
You want 2 Peter 1 and 20?
Yeah.
Knowing this verse.
Go over verse. Okay. Please.
We have also a more sure word.
See, we're
of
talking about we have a more sure word of doctrine or of gospel or better food to learn with and to ascertain and to understand that mankind has been purporting since the dawn of time of trying, number one, trying to find out when and where he's at. This man they call Jesus, because they were foretold this name. You don't have an I-N-R-I here, no formulating with the word J in here. I is for the Jewish language, EU, not Jews, but this is of the Hebrew writings up here, Hebrew, Greek, and Latin that were exposed up here. And what Peter's talking about, we're not coming with any devised cunningness of fables or words. Read.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Mm-hmm. And this is what we're trying, a prophecy. That's a vision. This is what Peter's coming out. If anybody's going to use that Bible in any kind of constructive way, one has to accept that Peter is talking about a vision, a prophetic vision. Just like in Proverbs, as Solomon wrote, it was a prophetic vision. He said he had a stupendous vision and revelation of what Moses wrote and what John wrote. Not to change it to how he wanted to write it or to tell it. Dr. Kinley said, hey, he's coming to confirm and to tighten it up and to see how this is what they said it was. Read.
Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed.
To eat. You do well to eat of this information, of this prophetic vision. Read.
As unto light that shineth in dark places.
As unto light, unto information. Isaiah talks about it in Isaiah 8 and 20. To the law and to the prophets. If they speak not according to this word, which is your first five books of the law, which was written by Moses. And then you have the prophets from Joshua to Malachi, which constitutes your prophetic visions or the prophecies. Or testimonies that were given unto them. And that compiles your Old Testament. And we've got to say, we're speaking by that. That's going to give you light. Give you some information that you're going to learn and digest and hear through your ears, just eating the words that by which we're preaching. Read.
A light that shineth in dark places until the day dawn.
Yes.
And the day star arises in your heart.
That's what this is what we're looking forward to by eating and digesting this information, to come to a clarity whereby we can sit with those around us, as is described here, without being frightened, without having tossed wind to and fro with every wind of doctrine. This is the information we're gathering. We're not gonna be able to impose it on anybody.
Right.
We're not going to be able to slay dragons. Because who fought for the children of Israel back in the early times of Moses? It was Yahshua. And he's still working the same fight here today. Therefore, we can't get high and mighty in our knowledge and our wisdom, because it's Yahweh's wisdom. Keep reading.
Knowing this first, mm-hmm. that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
It's not a private interpretation. Dr. Kinley received a divine vision and revelation, and he stuck to and told a line with what he saw. He didn't put any of his injecture in there. He didn't recreate it from a bunch of words. He looked at words. He read books to solidify and to shore up what was expressed. This is why Will was able to come back, coming back to what I talked about earlier, to be able to understand how Joshua, the son of Nun, was down here at the age of 30. And how Yahshua, when he came in preaching and started his ministry at the age of 30. He's coming from a point of view of a vision. It's in the book. We've experienced it. We talked about it. And then you got the 40 days that he was out here in the wilderness here. And Joshua the son of Nun tarrying with the children of Israel in the wilderness for 40 days. And then we know that after he came through this River Jordan, again, this River Jordan being the second departmental veil described here, coming through the River Jordan, and he tarried out here in the wilderness for 40 years. We read that last class, that he fought the Canaanites, brought down Jericho with his hand. And like we expressed, he wasn't even touched. Mm-hmm. Going back to the point that he lays down his life and he'll pick it up again. But it's in this guise that we have Yahshua, he having died on the cross, ascended, but tarried on earth for 40 days. Confirming this being Joshua, and then you have an additional 10 days after the death of Joshua that you have Pentecost, or the 50, when they did the Jubilee out here in Canaan's land. And same thing, the 50, after the 40 days, the 10 days later, when he ascended out of their sight, that he came and outpoured of the Holy Spirit on the time of in Acts, the second chapter, when he had a dispensation of his spirit into the minds and soul and body of these men, the Jews first, mind you. It didn't just go through the whole world osmosisly and everybody was just inundated with the spirit and everybody's love and caring. No, that's not the process by which we're still at it in the dispensation start. We're just starting the fifth dispensation. We're just starting the persecutions of this spiritual visionary concept that is not flesh and blood. It's the understanding of the gospel or the vision that was given unto these men, put it in their hearts and mind, whereby now they're able to dispense it according to that. They were told to go out and preach to the uttermost parts of the world, starting in Jerusalem first. And we have it here depicted with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Hebrews 12 and 1, please. And then we'll want Acts 10.
You want Hebrews mm-hmm. 1 and what?
12 and 1, please.
12.
Yeah. 10.
Hebrews 12 and 1.
Uh-huh.
Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses.
Okay.
Let us lay aside every weight.
Those witnesses are the scriptures.
Right.
The scriptures are that they're talking about, expressing about the great cloud of witnesses are the scriptures that they learned and they were taught, and about it by Yahshua the Messiah, about what it was that was in the law and in the prophets, to be able to have them speak what they're speaking now. Read.
And the sin which doeth so easily beset us.
And that's not having faith in Yahshua. We just read it in the scripture reading. That sin is the lack of faith in whom is our Savior. Read.
And let us run the race with patience.
Yes. That's that patience again with people around us that don't know have eaten bad things, even though they're trying to impart some information, trying to do the best they can, It's the patience that we have to have now, having the Spirit be in us. Read.
And let us run with patience
The
race that is set before us.
They still, this is the start of the fifth dispensation. There's things that are yet to be learned and understood about this divine Spirit. Read.
Look unto Yahshua, the what? Author and the finisher of our...
We talked about that last time. The author faith. And finishes of our what?
Faith.
Of our faith. You have to have faith in Yahshua, otherwise that's sin. Not what you eat. That's why he said don't worry about what other people are eating of their information. This naturally is that a lot of people becoming vegans. Romans 1:19 and 20, we take the physical things and understand spiritual things. Now we're looking at, hey, people are talking about vegans, the meat's bad, the world don't know about milk, they got almond milk, they got soy milk now because everybody's afraid of how this milk is in the products are packaged. With the longevity of the pesticides that are in there. Don't eat this, don't eat that, just on a natural basis. And all we're doing is flipping it to an understanding on a spiritual basis, as we have it described here, as far as the different doctrines and interpretations and ideas from the Pope all the way down to the atheists. Those are all different types of foods and different types of stuff that people eat intermittently, changing it up, having a little bit of this yoga, Hindu, having a little bit of this, and trying to formulate some kind of faith. But there is, just read it again. Reread that again.
Looking into Yahshua, the author and the finisher of our faith.
Of our faith. That they now, because of the outpouring Spirit, have all faith. Just as Stephen, when Stephen died here in the Acts, the 7th chapter, and he told them, the Pharisees and the scribes, about themselves. So much so that it pricked them to stone them. Because, hey, that's what Yahshua was Stephen's faith, of what he understood about Yahshua the Messiah. And it bode him well to do and say what he said, to preach the gospel at that time with Stephen. Now Acts 10, please.
Acts 10:1.
Mm-hmm.
There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius.
Okay.
A centurion of the band called the Italian.
This
band.
Is 7 years after this event in Pentecost on June 6th. 7 years later, we're now here with the Gentiles. Read.
A devout man and one that feared Elohim with all his house.
Fear as Cornelius, which is a centurion of Rome. That knew Yahshua. Read.
Which gave much alms to the people and prayed to Elohim always.
All right.
He saw in a vision evidently about the ninth hour of the day an angel of Yahweh coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, What is it, sir? And he said unto him, Thy prayers and thy alms are come up for a memorial before Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And now send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter.
That's Peter. That's the Peter that said, there in the second chapter, this is not, to know this verse, that it's not fables, and it's not things that we've taken up man, it's not something that we're working up on as far as these scriptures. And Peter's still talking about this information that he was received of him of the Spirit 7 years later. Cornelius is now going to seek this one Simon Peter. Read.
He lodgeth with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside.
Okay.
He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do.
Right.
And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually.
Right.
And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. On the morrow, as they went on their journey and drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth
hour. Now Peter, having his own vision. Again, we're back to the vision. Talking about visions again. And we're going to see about some food up here on top of this rooftop that Peter talking about. Read.
And he became very hungry. And would
he become hungry. Read.
And would have eaten, But while they made ready, he fell into a trance.
Mm-hmm.
And saw heaven open.
As Peter fell into a trance. He's taken up, read.
And a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet, fastened at the four corners and let down to the earth.
That's a veil principle here, the second departmental veil here in the tabernacle, this sheet. Because Peter's taken up onto the rooftop. And he's shown here, you got the plate. And it's shown here, or in the tabernacle here, this veil is taken, was dropped down for Peter at this time. Read.
Wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, Rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, Not so, Yahweh, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean.
Again, this goes back to where our scripture reading was about tonight a little bit, about eating something, herbs, eating this or eating that. And we're talking about unclean things, right. Talking about swine back here.
Right.
So you got Muslims and different people have different passions about the things you can eat and the things you can't eat. Mm-hmm. That's physical. But the Messiah is saying, hey, in the scriptures there, don't worry about what you're eating, physically so. But understand that what we're eating is spiritual food and the spiritual vision that we're receiving here, down here today. We're not coming down here to do right or act right according to our natural selves. Read.
And the voice spake unto him again the second time.
Okay.
What Yahweh hath cleansed, that call not thou common.
Mm-hmm.
This was done thrice, and the vessel was...
That's three times this is done. Understanding that Peter had information about swine and about what to eat, because that was back in the law.
Right.
That's why I said earlier, yeah, an outpouring Holy Spirit is the beginning of the fifth dispensation, but there were still things yet for them to learn. We read it there in the book there that said there's yet more to do. And have patience and run the race. They just started running the race. The race is learning about these things that Peter now is being made aware of up on this rooftop about food.
Right.
About what's good to eat and what's not good to eat. Read.
And the vessel was received up again into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Now while Peter wondered what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate.
All right, they're out here. They have Peter up on this roof, and now they're at this gate at Peter's house. Read.
And called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there.
Uh-huh.
While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, Behold, three men seek thee.
Okay.
Arise, therefore, and get thee down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them.
Have all faith in Yahshua the Messiah. That's what's speaking unto Peter. That's what Peter's able to witness and see and know. And this is why Peter's going to go with these men. We're just trying to jump down a little bit to when he's at the house and the Spirit falls upon them. Now to keep moving. I don't have much time.
44 maybe?
Yeah, 44 is right.
Yeah.
While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all of them which heard the word.
Go back up for verse or two before that. So you have Peter going with the three men by sanction of Yahshua to Cornelius, come and got the men. They got Peter. They come back to Peter's house and read them a few verses about them.
I'm going to go to 37.
Okay, that's fine.
That word I say ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the immersion which John preached.
Okay.
How Yahweh anointed Yahshua of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed by the adversary, for Yahweh was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him Yahweh raised up the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen beforehand.
Not everybody, Yahweh. That's what I said earlier, that when that Pentecost came 7 years prior to this event, everybody just didn't get it. They think Pentecost, you got a holy roller Pentecost, they make churches called Pentecost, as though everybody just received what was said in the book. He was just saying here that that wasn't so. Keep reading.
Even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead.
Mm-hmm.
And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained by Yahweh.
He preached unto the Jews only at that time, because now he's coming to, this is the first time they're coming to the Gentiles at Cornelius' house. Keep reading.
Ordained by Yahweh to be the judge of the quick and the dead.
Mm-hmm.
To him give all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins.
Whosoever now, this is what Peter talked about, whosoever now going to be able to receive it. Because now it's come time. We're in the 40. This happened 40 and a half years after the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. That's why we're in this plate here. This is in the holy place portion of this plate. You pick up the 40 principle. Read.
While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all of them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because on other nationalities also was poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit.
So now that's when the Gentiles now were able to begin to receive this information. It was 7 years after the death of the Messiah. He was 33 and a half years old. 7 plus the 33 going to put you at 40. And at this say here, now you've got the Gentiles coming into the promise that was given unto Abraham, fulfilling the Gentiles and bringing them into a knowledge and the information about who Yahshua Messiah was that hung on the cross. And now they're eating of this information. Prior to that, they had no clue what a Messiah was or who the Messiah was, guessing and speculating. But it's at this time with these disciples, or Peter primarily, that started this outpouring of information and preaching of the gospel. And now there's a whole period of time from this point on down through the Dark Ages. You've got your dispensations chart here. The New Testament was given here in the fourth age. It's when the outpouring of Pentecost started. And we just went through a little bit about the Jews first in Jerusalem. And then 7 years later, we just read about Cornelius at Cornelius' house. About the Gentiles receiving this law of the Spirit. And having to have some information about this Spirit. And then we go through a period of time until we come into 1931. When, again, the Messiah took a man by the name of Henry C. Kinney. And expose more information to us to be able to see and to confirm about what this conversion of the Gentiles was about. Of why these charts were expressed to be able to point to the information about who Yahshua was back here. What this tabernacle truly meant unto the children of Israel and unto us today.
Right.
To be able to use this and to prove ourselves and to stand fast in the knowledge and information of who we are. And I think it's just a beautiful story. And what Will went over as far as proving Yahshua. And it was a comment made after class, and I had to go back. You can grab me Judges, the second chapter, and maybe the second speaker can have me use this as a little springboard or something I'm not fully aware of, but I thought it prudent to understand the ascension again, or the vision of the spirit or angel that is talked about here in the second chapter, being Yahshua the Messiah or Joshua the son of Nun. Read.
Judges chapter 2. And an angel of Yahweh came up from Gilgal to Bochim.
This is after the children, this is before the kings. You have judges that are ruling the children, the nation of Israel that are up here in Canaan's land. Read.
I made you to go up out of Egypt and have brought you unto the land which I swear unto your fathers.
Now this angel is talking about what he did. That brought them down from Canaan's land here in Egypt for some 400 years. Read.
And I said, I will never break my covenant with you.
He said he made a covenant with them. Read.
And ye shall make no league with the inhabitants of this land. Mm-hmm. Ye shall throw down their altars.
Right.
Ye have not obeyed my voice.
That's the food, and that's those different denominations, if you would, of mingling with them and getting down and eating what they say eat and doing what they say do. But the spirit now resurrected here is speaking, read.
Why have you done this? Right? Wherefore, I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, mm-hmm. but they shall be as thorns in your sides, and their idols shall be a snare unto you.
These are things that are stumbling blocks that were put here for these children of Israel that just recently come across here into Jerusalem, read, after some 40 years.
And it came to pass, when the angel of Yahweh spoke these words unto all the children of Israel, mm-hmm. that the people lifted up their voice and wept. And they called the name of that place Bochim, and they sacrificed there unto Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And when Joshua had let the people go, mm-hmm. the children of Israel went every man unto his inheritance.
Man, that's beautiful information. I hadn't read that before, and I hope we can get into that expression of that Joshua that let the people go after this period of time. Because it shows that he resurrected or came back in that angel or in that spirit form at that time while in Canaan's land. Even though we read there at the end of Joshua, the 24th chapter, that he died at 110 years old, but that spirit we're talking about is speaking unto the children of Israel, and they did hear him. They did weep, because they were pricked. Because we have been given a profound panoramic vision to learn and to know whereby we can have some strength and some all confidence.
Right.
Once we understand the structure, the function of the tabernacle, how this migration pattern works, and to see how Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh in his pure spirit state, by these divine attributes, took on a shape and form known as Yahweh Elohim. Then that Yahweh Elohim, you can read there in John, the first chapter, the 14th verse, how this word became flesh and dwelt among mankind. They didn't know, they couldn't see him until he fulfilled. And then we know that through his spirit, and that's the same spirit we talked about, we read here just now in Judges, that filled the hearts and minds of those men. Just like the knowledge of this information ought to be feeding us and filling us with the spirit of Yahshua, the Messiah, whereby we can have some strength and some confidence here today, no matter what the weather's like, no matter what the racism's like, or the political party's like, that we keep our mind on the way, the truth, and the life, which is Yahshua, the Messiah. And with that, I'll have my seat. If you got anything out of what I've said tonight, all these praises go to Yahshua, the Messiah. Let us all say,
hallelujah. Okay, we'll call our second speaker up. You'll have the remainder of the time, and that would be Dr. Will Williams. Stupendous panoramic vision given to us by Yahweh Elohim, and I appreciate the first speaker. I thought he laid a very adequate foundation, brought up a lot of stuff. I'm like, why do you want to make an old man work so hard? I don't know. But it comes to that sometimes, as far as what he talked about Joshua, I thought he did a good conclusion on it myself. It was just the cherry on top of the cake we forgot to put on it the last time we did. Because for him to come down as Yahshua, he would have to be, he'd have to die, be buried, and resurrect again. Mm-hmm. See, that's why it was said down here about Yahshua. Yahshua said, well, the Son of Man must be, resurrected again.
Right.
Be back again. Why? If I did it before. See? However, I want to concentrate on the other things the first speaker brought up. He brought this point. I didn't expect that.
And I have a feeling, I don't know why, I had a feeling he was going to bring it up, but he did. He brought this up. And I may as well bring the other one up, 35. Because, see, when you correlate with these plates, you'll find, well, they all correlate with each other because it's all by the pattern. 34, 35. Okay? And they do. They all correlate with each other. But there are certain plates that have what I call an affinity. In other words, they tend to be connected in certain ways that maybe you didn't think about. I mean, they're all connected by the pattern. Like, these two plates. Whenever I do one, I have to do the other because they're both connected in a way that the story, when you understand the principle of the plates, okay? So, when he brought this one up, I was like, oh, no, he didn't. But I do. I say, okay, he brought this up. I got to bring this up. Because it started here, it goes down. These plates, ascend and descend. This is a descending plate. And he went through part of it, and we can read the rest of it. Acts 12 and 1.
Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex certain of the congregation.
This is Herod. This is Herod Agrippa the first. This Herod is the grandson of Herod the Great. Okay? Herod the Great killed his father because he felt his father was vying for the throne. And this Herod Agrippa, as a child, he was sent to Rome to live with the imperial family of Rome. I'm talking about the Caesars. He grew up with the second one.
Neo? Neo?
Who?
Neo?
Neo.
Yeah.
Who is Neo? I never heard of that Caesar. No, first it was Augustus, then Tiberius. Tiberius Caesar, yeah. Tiberius was the stepson of Augustus Caesar. This Herod grew up with him and his nephew, which is Gaius Caesar, which we know as Caligula, and Claudius Caesar. He was a good friend. He also knew Claudius Caesar. He grew up with the Herod, with the imperial family, because read that again.
Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands.
Stop. Who made him king? Mm-hmm. Who made him king?
Caesar.
It was the Caesar because he was buddy-buddy with them. Right. Look over here. See, we got a man sitting here, but look over here. See, here on this plate, see, we got a leopard. Why? Because, see, over here, we have a dragon.
Right.
See, the dragon, which is Rome, pagan Rome, right, gave its power in principle to papal Rome,
right,
or in principle, in this case, to Herod. Mm-hmm. That's a principle, see? That's going to repeat itself down the line. That's why Dr. Kinley drew it on here like this. Here you see the leopard, but up here is the man we're showing you who was pointing
right,
to. Because
right,
he was king. Well, who made him king? Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? It was the Caesars or pagan Rome that gave him that power. Okay, now you can continue.
And he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword.
Killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And that's blood. That's a bloodline. Draw a line. See the Passover innocent blood. See, draw a line here. Blood on the four horns. Here's Joshua here. Innocent blood. The blood here. See, that's a line. Draw a line. Okay? See, the principle of water. See, pagan persecution. The last speaker stopped up here with the Holy Spirit being poured out on them in AD 40. Alright, coming down, that's the Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that's the Spirit principle. Why? Because that lines up with the cloud. It lines up with the cup of holy anointing oil at the door. And seeing that's an immersion, because they went out, I'm talking about the Gentiles, they went out and preached too. So they immerse in the name. They went out preaching, immerse in the name. Now here's the blood, James being killed by Herod. See, this is a descending plate. here. Here with the blood. Now come over here. It's the same principle here. Blood here. And here, see, this is 10 years later. 10 years after Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. Bring up plate 31. See, this plate, this is an ascending plate. We started here, went down, now we're coming over, now we're going to ascend. And what it is, this is the resurrection reconfirmed. So what's happening here with Peter is a reconfirmation of what happened to Yahshua 10 years earlier, because this is A.D. 43. Continue.
And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also.
Uh-huh.
Then were the days of unleavened bread.
Unleavened bread. See, that's a type of a miracle. What is unleavened bread? No yeast. So there's no rise. See? Okay? And it was around the same, because it was around the same time of the Passover.
Right.
Which is when draw a line. This is when Yahshua was offered up, around the Passover. April the 14th, to be exact. Because he's fulfilling it, so it's got to be that way. Here, and here's the resurrection reconfirmed the same day. Peter in the same situation. Continue.
And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him.
Four quaternions. What is a quaternion? That's a squad of four.
Right.
So principle of four. Why? Draw a line. Wasn't there 4 points of blood on the door down here with the Israelites?
Right.
Wasn't there 4 points of blood, four horns on with the four horns here?
Yes.
And wasn't Yahshua, when he was crucified, didn't he have 4 points of blood on him?
Yeah.
See, I went over here just to show that, but it's the same over here. Mm-hmm. He's got 4 points of blood on him.
Yes.
Peter is reconfirming. Continue.
Intending after Passover to bring him forth to the people.
Uh-huh.
Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing by the congregation unto Yahweh for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains.
Two soldiers, okay. Why two soldiers? Well, let's draw a line. Wasn't there two soldiers up here that guarded Yahshua's tomb? You get it? All right. And come over here. Here's the Red Sea. When the Israelites came to the Red Sea, there was two mountains on both sides that they had to go through, as well as the Red Sea. You see what I'm doing? I'm just lining it up here, okay? Line upon line. Precept upon precept, which is a principle. The blood, the water, the spirit. See, and the other steps of the pattern. See, the light, the bread, the intercessor, the veil, the Ark of the Covenant representing the throne. See, all of these things are, you have to use to be able to see the purpose of Yahweh in operation. Continue.
And the keepers before the door guarded the prison.
Uh-huh.
And behold, the angel of Yahweh came unto him, and a light shined in the prison.
Read.
And he smote Peter on the side,
uh-huh,
and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands.
Okay, now the angel smote him in the side. Why did he smote him in the side? Draw a line. Wasn't Yahshua smote? Here he is. He's being smote in the side by the Spirit. You see that? Okay, come over here. Wasn't that lamb down in Egypt? Wasn't it smote in the side? It was pierced in the side, remember? No bones could be broken, right? See? Continue.
And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did.
Mm-hmm.
And he saith unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me.
Mm-hmm.
And he went out and followed him and realized not that it was true which was done by the angel,
mm-hmm,
but thought he saw a vision.
Breathe.
When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of its own accord.
It opened of its own accord. Why? Come over here. See, the same way here. These guys were knocked out. They fell asleep. And the boulder rolled away of its own accord. It was really the angel that made it do that. Mm-hmm. But for Peter's part, it's like, oh, it just opened up. Draw a line. Oh, what about right here? Here's the Red Sea. Didn't that open up too? And there was an angel there, because remember the cloud, they was following this phenomenal cloud that had an angel in the cloud. So who opened the Red Sea? See, Because remember, we read, if you read the story, Moses said, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh. And then Joshua standing next to him and says, why are you crying to me? Because he said, stand still and see the salvation, which is the same thing as saying, stand still and see Joshua. And he's standing right there. And he's saying, why are you crying to me? Lift your rod up so the people could go forward. It looked like Moses was doing it, but it was really him that right. did that. Because it wasn't time for him to reveal himself yet. See? Continue.
And they went out and passed on through one street. And forthwith the angel departed from him.
Uh-huh.
And when Peter had come to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that Yahweh hath sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Miriam, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying.
Mm-hmm.
And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate.
Okay, now the first person Peter sees is a woman.
Right.
See, he sees a woman when he comes up out of prison, because literally he's coming up out of death, burial, resurrection. So when he comes up, the first thing he sees is a woman. Come over here. Here's Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. And here's Mary. And she, the first one he sees is a woman.
Right.
You can take it back to Adam, because when Adam was put into a deep sleep, and he woke up, wasn't there a woman at his feet? See? Oh, we can show that in the prophecy. You can read in the book of Ruth, where Boaz, after the harvest was brought in, and after he got to work in, you know how we fellas are, get a little taste. Hard day's work, let's kick back and relax, get a little taste. And he fell asleep, and then when he woke up around midnight, a woman was sleeping at his feet, who was Ruth.
Right.
But she was a near kinsman. She was Naomi's daughter-in-law, and she was trying to petition for Naomi, who had lost everything. See, and Boaz had to redeem them. Why? Because this is what Yahshua did. His death burial is that he redeemed us. He redeemed us. And here, what Peter is showing you is the resurrection reconfirmed, or that redemption being reconfirmed. Because some people would say, oh, this never really happened. But then here's Peter. What's happening to Peter is a reconfirmation that Yahshua did go through a death, burial, and resurrection and ascension. Okay? Now, I said this here. These two plays have an affinity, because to me, it's just hard to use one without the other, because they really connect to each other. As we said, the first speaker went through it. He talked about this play up here, how Peter was on the housetop. See, that's the most holy place. And then the sheet came down. That's a type of the veil, or the Jordan River, or the veil. And it was three times that it happened. Why? Because the high priest on the Day of Atonement went up in here three times. You can even go back here with Moses. How many times did Moses go up the mount?
Three times.
See, Yahshua, in fulfillment of that, had to go up a mount three times. And he went up more than that, but three specific times to fulfill Moses. Even here, draw a line. When Yahshua came out to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, how many times did he check on his disciples? Three times. You see what I'm saying here? When you understand, that's why I tell y'all. And people think I'm stupid for saying it, but please, read the Bible. Sit down and read it. Read the books, all of them, all 67 books. Oh, you trying to study up on it? No, I'm trying to get you familiar with it, because you're not going to remember every little thing unless you have a photographic memory. But because it's in there, and here, Yahweh will bring it back to your remembrance. You say, oh, wait a minute, didn't I read something like that? He'll bring it back to your remembrance, but he can't bring nothing back to your remembrance, something you didn't put there. And he's telling you to read this. We always say to the law and to the testimony, well, then read it. right? And also read both versions. Our founder really harped on that. Be familiar with the King James Version as well as the Holy Name Version, because there are differences of scripture, like we went through today about the King James Version, where there is no vision,
right. The
people perish. But the Holy Name, which I think is a more superior one, where there is no prophet. prophetic vision that people pay. So, you know, you have to be familiar so you can know which one you want to quote from. Because sometimes you may want to, you know, the Holy Name version of that scripture is a better elucidation. In other cases, the King James version. And even then, when you want to translate it, you know, because like we say, well, how do I know what to say? The Lord, the God. In the Old Testament, when you see the Lord, most cases, just say Yahweh. When you see God in the Old Testament, most cases, it'll be Elohim. Now, in some cases, Trainer in the Holy Name, he'll embellish it. He'll say something like Yahweh or something, or El Shaddai, or El Elyon, you know, something like that. Then it would behoove you to find out what they mean. See, so that when you want to use it, you know, like, you know, yeah, then you know. Like the other day, we were going through this epistle of Barnabas. See, the only reason why I knew that was because I read the scripture where that came from. Because I know in the King James, that's how it said, but I know in the Holy Name, it'll say, well, Yahweh said to my Eloah. See, that's a big thing. See, you see, because in the so-called New Testament, it's not going to, the rules are a little different. That's why I say you have to read it so that you can compare certain scriptures and then you kind of know, okay, well, I know this says like this or this one says it like that, that kind of thing, see. But it's Yahweh who's going to show you and teach you if you take the time to read it. And our Father did say that you got a book. Try reading it sometime. And that's all I'm doing. We're just reading the scriptures and using the pattern. That's why people can't say that because I hear, well, you come over here. No, I'm reading it from the Bible, and we got the illustration, and we got a pattern to look at. Now, you want to argue with somebody, I would suggest you argue with the man who received the vision.
Right.
Because I didn't make this up. Mm-hmm. Especially when you can just, you know, golly, what? Yahshua said this. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, you know? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. What can be anything easier than reading? We ain't asking you to bring in a bullock or a turtle dove or a goat or something. We ain't, there's no altar up here. You know, we're not asking for any tithes or nothing like that. Yeah, we tell you to come in and sit down, you know, but, you know, and you know, I mean, you know, it's free will donation and all like that. You know, it's always been that way. I heard somebody in the lecture say, Dr. Kelly died a pauper. That's pretty much true. But we had millionaires in the class, in the L.A. class. I remember this one woman. She was, I never met her, but I had heard of her. Her name was Mrs. West. And she was a multimillionaire. And I heard a story. Well, no, I think it's even in a lecture somewhere where Dr. Kelly had said that she wanted to fund, she had enough money, she was a multimillionaire, that to fund the whole peace mission. And Dr. Kelly wouldn't let her because he felt that, well, if you did that, then nobody else would feel like they had a part in it. In that sense. So he just told her, he said, well, I'll tell you what you do. Just write out a check. Because she had a checkbook out in the business. He said, whatever you, amount you want, I'll write it out. But Dr. Kelly told her, he said, no, you don't have to do that. Just, you know, like I said, we want other people, you know, to feel like they have something in it. So just write out a check for $1,000. And that's what he took from her. This chick was so rich. I don't know if y'all, you might be old enough to remember this. This was like maybe 30 years ago in a National Enquirer. This woman's daughter died, okay, and she was so rich that the daughter in her will said that she wanted to be buried with her Corvette, you know, sitting in the, driving the Corvette with the sunglasses and a scarf and all that. That was her daughter. And she had that kind of money that she was going to be, I'm talking about buried with her Corvette in the ground. And she's sitting there at the wheel, you know, just, you know, really.
As her coffin.
Yeah, it was that was that woman's daughter. Her mom was in class. I don't think she was in class. I don't think so. But yeah, but that was the woman's daughter. You know, this was years ago. And people, I looked down, I was like, this is crazy. But some people got money like that. And then I found out that her mother was a regular class member. You know, I was like, oh, no wonder she, because I had heard of Mrs. West. She was like a multimillionaire, you know. Okay, so I just thought I'd throw that in there. But, okay, let's get Acts 15 and 1. Okay, because see, this is a split here. See here, this is AD 43, Mary Mark in Jerusalem. We just read that, Peter meeting Rhoda, okay? Now here, this is AD 52, the council at Jerusalem. See, this is happening here, and this is germane to to this plate, as I'll show you, I hope to show you in a moment.
Okay. Acts 15 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved.
Mm-hmm.
And when Saul and Barnabas had no small dissension or disputation with them, they determined that Saul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the congregation, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the nations. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the congregation of all the apostles and elders, and they declare all things that Yahweh had done with them.
Okay, now, this is AD 52. This is 12 years after Peter introduced the gospel to the Gentiles. The Gentiles received the Holy Spirit that was brought out by the first speaker. All right, so this is 12 years later. And other folks, like Paul particularly, and Barnabas, they went out to these nations and they preached to the Gentiles. And they brought Gentiles into the fold, okay? In a lot of cases, what they had to do, I'm talking about Paul and Barnabas, what they had to do, they had to indoctrinate the Gentiles into the Hebrew culture.
Right.
Because they didn't know, because as far as they were concerned, they were like, okay, well, who's Yahshua? Well, Yahshua is, you know, he's the propitiation of the sins of the world. What is sin? Mm-hmm. Well, sin came about with Adam. Who is Adam? Well, Adam is the first man. You know, they had to explain the law and the prophets to them. They had to explain the history of the Jews, of the Hebrews. They had to explain about Adam and Eve and Noah and Abraham. And they had to explain all of that to them, to indoctrinate them into that. That's what Paul and, you know, when they talked to the Gentiles, because they had no knowledge of it, okay? And what Paul did was, he talked about how, because he was a man, Paul himself was a man who studied under the feet of Gamaliel. See, and the reason why was because he was born a eunuch. And because he was born a eunuch, according to the law in the 613 ordinances, he was not allowed in the assembly. However, his father was kind of a well-to-do guy because Paul's trade, he had a trade. He was a tent maker, okay? And he was born, you got it right here, Saul of Tarsus. He was born in Tarsus. And because he was born in Tarsus, Tarsus was a Roman colony. And because he was born in a Roman colony, he was automatically conferred Roman citizenship at birth because he was born in a Roman colony. So he was able to use that as an advantage. You know, maybe we'll get into another lesson on that. But he was kind of an odd kind of a guy, you know, to the Hebrews, because he was the one, the same one who persecuted, you know, that was brought out over here. See, it was brought out over here about Stephen's death. Okay, and that, you know, and when and if you ever read the scripture, Paul, you know, was the guy holding their coat, because, you know, they put him in the, you know, Stephen in the pit, and they was going to throw rocks, and so they was like taking off their tunics, so, you know, they get some throwing room, and they threw it over there, and there's a guy, a little guy named Paul, and he, you know, standing there, and he's holding everybody's clothes, so to speak, while they are getting some rocks and big stones, and they, you know, they pummeling Stephen. So he was considering that because he was like that, you know, he was all these guys' clothes and stuff, their cloaks. And then he was given letters of authority to hunt these people down and bring them to justice, see? All right? And the reason why they were capable of doing that because, see here, this is pagan Rome. See, draw a line. Pagan Rome was the one that killed or executed Yahshua. The reason why, because at that time, they were under a governorship. That governor was Pontius Pilate, okay? He was a direct authority. In other words, the Hebrews, the Sanhedrin Council, could issue a death sentence, but they could not carry it out. They did not have the authority, all right? They had to go to Pontius Pilate to do that. He had the authority, and he was reluctant himself, because he was like, you know, who's this guy? This guy ain't did nothing, you know? But the custom was, you know, they had to release somebody. And so they released Barabbas instead, right? I'm trying not to get into a tangent, but I'm trying to show this principle of authority.
Right.
See, because when Pilate killed Yahshua, he was killed, and he was supposedly, it was brought out right here. He was, this is Latin, this is not Hebrew. Let me tell you that right now. This is not, even though the sign was put up in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. This right here, that's Latin. You know, Irenaeus, Nazareth, Rex, Judea, in Latin. That's really what it is. In other words, this is Yahshua, King of the Jews, in Latin. You know, but I mean, you can't put all three signs up there, because there was a sign in Latin, there was a sign in Greek, and there was a sign in Hebrew. It just would take up too much space, so they just, shortened it like that. That's really what it was, okay? And see, because he was considered the King of the Jews, and he was executed, anybody following him would be like a part of a subversive group. So really, here, when they killed Stephen, they didn't have to ask Pilate for permission because they could say, oh, we're just mopping up the elements of this, this Nazarene resistance, because he had followers. See, we killed the Jews, so we're just getting the rest of them. And so that was okay because the precedent had already been set. Now here, Herod, he comes along, he was made king, and he was ruling all the, he didn't have to ask anybody. He doesn't say, oh, well, I need to go ask the Romans. No, he just said, kill them. Because he had the authority. The Romans, pagan Rome, gave the power to pagan Rome, or Herod, so to speak, okay? Continue reading. I know but I just wanted to get that in. Because, look, you have to take into consideration what's going on in these things. That's why we tell you to read the Bible. So that you would know the events and kind of get an idea of what's happening. That's why we go through all this other stuff. And bring up history and stuff. Dr. Kinley was very good at history. A lot of people don't realize that. If they would just take advantage of the historical notes that he took and talked about, you would understand these charts a lot better, I think. At least to me, but that's me. Continue.
And there rose up a certain of the sect of the Pharisees,
uh-huh,
which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses.
Okay, now the Pharisees, let's say something about them. They were a sect, and we've been through this in workshop, that got created, that they were a sect who believed in the resurrection.
Right.
There were also Pharisees that believed that Yahshua was the Messiah, especially after he resurrected. People like Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, who donated the tomb. So it fell right in line with their philosophy, because their philosophy was performing these cardinal ordinances. Well, as far as they were concerned, they saw Yahshua perform these cardinal ordinances. And they saw him, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. But what they did not see was the end. They did not realize that his death was the end of these cardinal ordinances. See, and that's very critical. And I hope I have enough time to at least throw it, get to that, and maybe we can dwell on it in a workshop. But read.
And the apostles and elders came together for the consider of this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago Yahweh made choice among us that the nations by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And Yahweh, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit, even as he had did us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts and faith by faith.
Mm-hmm.
Now, therefore, why tempt Yahweh to put a yoke upon the necks of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of Yahshua Messiah, we shall be saved, even as they. Then all the multitude kept silent, and gave audience to Barnabas and Saul, declaring what miracles and wonders Yahweh had wrought among the nations by them.
Okay. Now, Peter had to stand up in the midst. See, why? Just draw a line. He did the same thing over here 12 years earlier. See, with the Gentiles. He stood up. Same thing. He's mediating, so to speak. And the words he spoke was by the Spirit. That was the bread. Same thing happened to these folks like it did on Pentecost, the light, it's like the light, they were illuminated. And see, and it's the same principle here. The words that Peter spoke, they were spirit, they were light. It's by the Holy Spirit. That's like the bread. He's intercessing. And what he's doing is illuminating the consciousness. Also what he's doing, he's also rending the veil of the flesh between Jew and Gentile. Well, that happened here. But he's reconfirming it here. See, not only is this the resurrection reconfirmed, it's also the renting of the veil between Jew and Gentile. That is reconfirmed too. See, here. Why? Draw a line. Draw a line. What do we got here? We have Solomon's temple. Why am I pointing to Solomon's temple? Well, what did Solomon's temple, what was the construction of it? What was it? Speak up so we can hear.
Porch, sanctuary, and oracle.
It was a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. It was threefold, right? Mm-hmm. See, we could get as persnickety as we want. This was on a mountain. See, it had two giant brass chapiters that even had names. Right. One was called Boaz, and the other was called Jochebed. See, and they would be like giant legs because, see, each level was on a gradiating extension. The porch was at one level, then the next level up was the sanctuary, and then the next level up on the mountain was the oracle. In other words, looking at it from a distance with the big giant brass chapters, it looked like a man had a golden dome on the head. It looked like a man sitting on a throne. And see, and during the day, the light would reflect off the sun, there would be a bright light. You know, you'd be like, oh, wow, what is that? Like a beacon. Right. Why? Draw a line. That would be like the flash of the Shekinah. Even at night, like on a full moon, and they would see that the reflection of the light from this dome, even at night, they'd be saying, wow, what is that? It's that bright light over there. Oh, man, that's the house of Yahweh in Jerusalem. See? All right? But now also, this temple, we talked about the porch. The porch was threefold. There was a porch for the priest,
right.
There was a porch for the Jews,
right.
And there was a porch for the Gentiles. In other words, there was a separation. There was a partition, see? Now Solomon, who built this temple, see, he had 700 wives and 300 concubines, okay? Now, I don't know if he was like Wilt Chamberlain and he went through them all, perhaps, you know, I mean, I'm sure, like any red-blooded man, you know, you'd give it a good try.
That's right.
However, most of these marriages were political marriages. Okay, like, for example, Solomon was married to the sister of the Pharaoh of Egypt. Okay? And because by marriage, you know, that's like strengthening bonds, okay? You know, you're my brother-in-law. You know, I help you at your time of need, you help me, you know, because we family. We family, okay? One of the conditions that Solomon made when he made these kind of marriages was this. Look, okay, I'll marry your sister, Pharaoh, but this is what you got to do. At least once a year, you got to come to Jerusalem and give alms unto Yahweh. And he said that to all of them. I mean, he had 700 wives, and they were like either the brother or the daughter, you know, they were either the sister of a king or they were the daughter of a king. And he would tell them, you know, you got to come to Jerusalem at least once a year, at least that, and give alms unto Yahweh. Now, can you imagine, you know, your 700 in-laws showing up in one place? Okay? From different nations? Why? Go back here to Adam. Go back to Adam. Well, I tell you what, I won't do that. Plato 11. Right there. Here's the man Adam. He's made from the dust of the ground. And Yahweh breathed in him the breath of life. That's a death, before that, that's death. It's all corollary, all right? Just dead, and now he is immersed in the breath of life and the spirit. See, because we got the division now between body and soul. And see, and Adam became a living soul. And now here we have the division between soul and spirit. The spirit law was imbued in Adam, not not after this, before, because it was the spirit law. See, this is descending, that put this body together, and now this body is ascending back up to here. See, body, soul, spirit. And if you notice, there's animals around there.
Right.
Okay? Because when he was created, he was told that he was given dominion over the animals. And in fact, Yahweh brought the animals to him to be named. The male and the female. Mm-hmm. See, of each species. And so Adam is standing here, and all these animals are like lined up, you know, they just lined up around him. They just lined up, you know, surrounding him, you know, and he's naming them off, you know, lion, giraffe, cheetah, monkey, dog, cat, you know, bird, you know, I mean, he's just naming them all, the male and the female of their species. And he's standing there, and look, and so now, if they're the male and female, if they're the first, that means that they are the king
right.
and queen of their species. Because they're the first. They're the progenitors of the rest of their species. So now their king and queen of their species is the man Adam. He's standing up there naming them. So what does that make him?
King.
That makes him king of kings. From a natural standpoint. Draw a line. Here is king of kings. Joshua's king of kings. He's fulfilling that. But come over here. Come over here to Solomon. Because when they came and met those 700 in-laws and stuff, Solomon would go out and meet them on the porch. They would be, you know, he would go out on the patio and see, here's the court of the priests, here's the court of the Hebrews, and the court of the Gentiles. And so the Gentiles, he would greet them. He would greet all of them. And then he'd come to the court of the Gentiles, his 700 in-laws is there, his brother-in-laws, his father-in-law, and they brought their wives, male and female, and so here's Solomon, and they king and queen of their own country,
right.
And here's Solomon standing up over them on the patio, looking down into the court of the Gentile, king of kings. This is Joshua, because when he resurrected from the grave, death, burial, resurrection, 40 days he tarried, see, and then he ascended, and then day of Pentecost, and then the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm.
See, he's showing that he is Jew. He's king of kings. Mm-hmm. Over everything, he's the king of kings. That's really what it's pointing to him. Okay? Now, what I want to do, how much time I got? I don't have much, but I'll just throw it out there. Plate 37. All right. Now we read in Acts about these Pharisees, okay? And you know how they said that the Gentiles had to keep the law of Moses. What I'm trying to explain is in a short way, we've done this before, but I'm explaining that this is the origin of the Roman Catholic Church.
Right.
See, because these folks infiltrated themselves into class. And they, you know, even though they were set right by Peter, it didn't get rid of them. They stuck around. They stuck around till after the apostles were dead. See? And then they said, and just like today, you know, people say, well, now, you know, Dr. Kennedy's gone. Now we can tell you some things we couldn't tell you before. Once the apostles were dead, see, especially after John, here on the Isle of Patmos, see, he was the last one in AD 96. Most of them were gone like 30 years prior to this. Like in AD 66, AD 67, Peter died around that time. Paul died around AD 66. They were the last. The other ones, they were killed before then. But when John was gone, I mean, it was already working, but then once John was off the scene, it was like, okay, we go full blown now because all the eyewitnesses are gone. And what they did was reinstitute carnal ordinances. That's why we have on this plate. Carnal ordinances restored. Who restored them? The Pharisees we read about in Acts. They believed in the resurrection. They believed in carnal ordinances. This is where the Roman Catholic Church got started, because after the apostles were gone, then they start getting into the Holy Eucharist, Start doing that, transubstantiation, consubstantiation, water baptism, and all of the cardinal ordinances and more. And then this is where we got come up into, see, Mystery Babylon. See, where we got the Roman Catholics as if they're the mediators, the Jews as if they are the light of the world, and the Protestants with their Bible hand, like they have the bread. And then we got these all these other religions with question marks and exclamation points. See, this is mystery. This is the confusion. This is where all these different religions and concepts. See, just like here, just like down here. Okay? You see that? You see this here? See, it's the same as this here. Mm-hmm. See? See, we got the Pope here too, see? He's over here. It's the same thing in principle. And see, here's the thing. Like this, you gotta walk through this. You got to come just the same way here. See? And then but here, this is where we see. This is what we see Yahshua. Whereas the world, they right. go through this and they see,
right.
they see him sitting up there. They see him on the veil. See? And see, this is the court round about the unholy place and the most unholy place. Okay? Now, come back here, and we've told you about this plate. This is spiritual temple plate. This is the operate. What you are illustrating here and looking at is the operation of the Holy Spirit in a vessel. Whereas this is the operation of the mystery of iniquity in a vessel. This is what we all were before we came here. See, we did all kind of cardinal ordinances. You say, well, whatever religion, and you said, no, I was an atheist. Okay, fine. You invented your own particular cardinal ordinances. It may not have been like some of this stuff here, but you had your own concepts and things that you did that you felt like, well, I think this is okay. I'm going to do this or whatever. See, when we say cardinal ordinances, we talk about these 613. These were the ones that Yahweh gave Israel. Maybe let's read it. Romans 2:14. Throw this out there. We're not going to be able to go through this, but I want to throw it out there just to give you an idea of what we're dealing with. Because then when we start getting over here, see with this chart, see for you to understand this chart, you're going to have to understand the elementary chart and some of these plates a little bit better to understand what's happening here. Because this is the full-blown explanation of what's happening on that plate there. Okay? This is just more of a historical thing, but read.
For when the Gentiles, which have not the law.
Now the Gentiles did not have these specific, they didn't have this, Yahweh didn't tell them to do these 613 ordinances.
Right.
He gave these to the Hebrew people only, but read.
Do by nature the things contained in the law.
Now the Gentiles did by nature the things contained, in other words, there were people that came up with their own forms of baptism and circumcision and ceremonies and suppers and laws and sacrifices and stuff like that. They just came up with it on their own. Yahweh didn't tell them to do it. But they did it all according to the volition of what they thought of what their own concepts was. And they just felt like, oh, this is something we should do. Our God or God has said do this and we'll be fine. And it just happened to be similar to some of the stuff that's in the 613 ordinances. But what?
These, having not the law, are a law unto themselves.
They're a law unto themselves. It's what human government is. It's a law unto themselves. Yahweh didn't tell them to do that, but they took it upon themselves to make a law unto themselves. That's why in all these different empires, even up to today, they have rituals and ceremonies. And things you have to do, even in a political sense, even in a communist world, there are certain rituals and things you have to do, or else you're not a good communist. And concepts and things governments is no different. Governments want to be worshipped just like everybody else. They want to exhibit the same attributes that Yahweh has. And Yahweh is wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, strength. Don't you think they want to exhibit that same thing? The thing about it is it's carnal.
Right.
You know, they want you to love your country. Oh, I pledge allegiance to the flag, and, you know, for which it stands, and all this. Oh, you know, they want you to love me. You know, to love us. You know, we can ready to have elections. You know, based on systems. You know, show forth your wisdom, your intelligence, your knowledge, your love, the beauty, the justice, the foundation, power, strength. And look, you got people that exhibit so those qualities in different ways. Oh, this is my version of beauty. It may not be for you, but this is my version of love it or leave it. You know, that kind of thing, you know? And listen, you know, none of these governments,
right,
you know, none of these governments are sanctioned by Yahweh in this sense. I mean, they're all, you know, they're all of the adversary because it all comes from the Tower of Babel. And you can even go before that with the city of Enoch, okay? The scripture says this, there are none righteous, no, not one. So if that be the case, what is a nation? A nation is a collection of people, individuals, right? And if they're all not righteous, that means that nation is not righteous either. Because a nation is based on peoples.
Right.
So if none are righteous, then neither are none of these nations. They're not righteous either. Okay? You know, now, some may treat their people a little better than others, or something like that. That might be possible, but there's no such thing as a perfect country.
Right.
Very few countries last as long as, you know, last for a long time. Very few. I think I did some research, and maybe it's like maybe two or three countries that had lasted like over 1,000 years, you know. And one of them is the Vatican. It's been around like 1,800 years. I mean, of course, it's been a city-state since the 18th century, since King Emmanuel, you know, set it apart. But as an organization, you know, I mean, the Roman Catholic Church has crowned people kings and queens. You understand what I'm saying? You know, going all the way back, you know, to after the days of John the Revelator, you know, the Apostle John the Revelator. And we talked about it. We talked about Constantine. And how he, you know, when he became emperor, and he saw the strong delusion sent by Yahweh, you know, to put the so-called sign on his shield, and they would win the day. And that sign became the symbol or the keys to the Roman Catholic Church. See, but he was the one that sanctioned, because when he became Christian, so to speak, then the whole empire became Christian, and the Christian religion all of a sudden got government sanction, you know? Like, okay, we're the government now. Whereas before, they had been persecuted under the days of Augustus, Tiberius Caesar, Caligula, Gaius. They had been persecuted. Burnt on crosses and stuff like that, hiding underground and stuff. These are our forebearers, so to speak, you know? And they were not Christians either. They weren't called Christians at that time. Christian, I think the term Christian was a name of derision that they adapted, and, you know, just say, well, you know, we'll own this, you know. But they weren't, because they, as it started off with Hebrews first. The gospel was preached to Hebrews first, see, and then 7 years for 7 years, and then 7 years later, the Gentiles were brought in. And that's when the gospel really began to take off. People like Paul. See, Paul was the first. He was the first apostle to preach to people in Europe. He was the first one to do that. And see, he preached to, even though the Gentiles came in by Peter, it was Paul that really took it out, you know, to the Gentile world. Dr. Kinley even said, he said he went on more voyages, went through more persecution, wrote more books than anybody else. You know, he was really the greatest of them all. And even he himself, to my Paul, said, I said, look, I'm not a whit behind the chiefest apostle, because he wasn't with them when they were with Yahshua, but Yahshua made him an apostle. See, because he made him an eyewitness. The reason why, because Paul was very good in the law and the prophets, which testified of who?
Yahshua
the Messiah. So all Yahshua did was just quicken that which was in him and made him an eyewitness through the scriptures. And it's the same thing now. I got into it before. You can't do it today. First speaker kind of alluded to it. That this was the fifth dispensation. And see, during the fifth dispensation, the only way you could receive the Holy Spirit was through an apostle.
Right.
And that lasted until Dr. Kinley come along, until he changed the sixth, because he was getting ready to die. And then so if he was the only apostle on the scene, then what are you going to do? Hey, I got to make a dispensational change. I got to make you all apostles now. Mm-hmm. Make you all eyewitnesses by understanding the law and the prophets through the Holy Spirit. And by that, see, you are now capable, and that's the double portion in this dispensation, to be able to receive the Holy Spirit, and through preaching this gospel, you're able to give it to somebody through the Holy Spirit. See, that's the double portion. That's what Dr. Kinley changed before he died. And that was at the 75 convention. He didn't speak either. He did not speak at that convention, but his lieutenants did. Why? Because he changed it. Now they can get up, and through them, people receive the Holy Spirit through their preaching because of the dispensational change. See, these are things we try to tell you. If you take the time and study this material, and some people say, well, you can't study up on it. No, we're not. But we can review the record.
Right.
You really don't have to study. You just have to review the record and look at it, and Yahweh will explain it to you. The vision will explain itself to you. I've always said this. The more you engage these charts or this vision, the more it will engage you. And it will teach you if you allow it. See? But you got to follow the rules the Father laid out. You have a pattern, you have the law and the prophets, you have a migratory track, you have the universe at large. You have your physical body. As it was read earlier, you know, we're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And just like it was brought out about that path, the truth, you know, like Peter, keep your eyes on Yahshua. See, don't be distracted by these things, because if you do, you'll sink. Not until the Holy Spirit is born in you. Once the Holy Spirit is born in you, then you are sealed with the Holy Spirit, and there is no sinking. See, there's no backsliding. It never was. The trick is, you got to slide all the way in. All the way into the bosom of Yahshua. Okay? Thank you very much for your time and your patience. We, as always, we hope we're edifying. Okay? Be safe. Be healthy. But the most important thing, be in Yahshua, who truly is your only hope of glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Alrighty, that concludes tonight's lectures. Our hearts go out to Eunice Risers. Our daughter's feeling ill. She's up there helping her out. Okay, hopefully she'll be back Sunday. Alright, and those that are ill too and that can't make it, or elderly, give a shout out to them. Okay, we have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays 7:30, 9:30. All donations can be held by the, hold it till Sunday, okay? And let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good class.